there's consensus that poverty is multidimensional, and this has been recognized as early as in the 1980s with the minimum basic needs. And in the case of the Philippines, the government has started monitoring it through the minimum basic needs community-based information system in the early 1990s. And so we were looking at indicators relating to survival, security, and enabling needs. Moreover, the National Statistics Office, which is now called the Philippine Statistics Authority, has implemented the annual poverty indicator survey to capture the non-income-based measures of poverty. And the annual poverty indicator survey has been conducted many times since 1998, and the most recent one was in 2014. And our socioeconomic planning minister, Arsenio Balisacan, and I believe he attended the first meeting, has estimated the multidimensional poverty index by considering three dimensions: health, education, and standard of living. And he estimated it to be around 28.2% in 2008. And in fact, he has identified a target of 16 to 18% in 2016, as contained in the updated Philippine Development Plan. However, it is also noted that dimensions of poverty included in the current MPI has been constrained by the availability of data and surveys conducted by the Philippine Statistics Authority. So, although it's recognized that there are other dimensions that would need to be included in the MPI, the availability of data has been the major challenge. Moreover, weights have to be informed by societal norms. And so as of now, it's not yet an official statistics, but there are efforts to come up with an MPI that would go through the process. And the process is presenting it to the Technical Committee on Poverty Statistics. And after a review, a recommendation is made to the Philippine Statistics Authority Board before it's finally institutionalized. So there's actually this opportunity for researchers to contribute to the development and finalization of the MPI in terms of the dimensions that can be supported by data as well as the weights. And in terms of uses of MPI, MPI can be a useful tool in prioritizing areas or groups. It can facilitate use of multiple criteria in identifying target groups or areas. For instance, spatial areas or population subgroups that are more deprived or poor in many dimensions should be prioritized. Or households or individuals who are more deprived or poor in many dimensions should be prioritized. And this is actually, we see MPI as a way of facilitating this use of many criteria in targeting. And this could have significant implications on current targeting schemes. Why? Because, for instance, in the updated Philippine Development Plan, there are efforts to accelerate poverty reduction by focusing on priority provinces. And there are three categories right now, and they are based in terms of magnitude of poor households, or highest provincial poverty incidence, or provinces with high vulnerability to natural disasters. So these are based, the first two are basically income-based, but there's scope for incorporating other dimensions, particularly since we're actually interested in reducing not just income poverty, but other dimensions of poverty as well. And in the case of our conditional cash transfer program, the targeting scheme being adopted is a proxy means test model for income. And so again, there could be important implications for targeting in case the MPI is developed and institutionalized. But I think I'd also like to point out that beyond the use of MPI at the national level, the use of MPI for targeting can actually be extended to the local level. And there's very important recognition of the role of local governments in countries with decentralized structures, and I think this applies for most of the countries. If you want no one to be left behind, then there's no recourse but to go local. Nationally representative sample surveys are often not disaggregated enough. Moreover, they cannot identify who and where the MPI poor are. So together with indicators in the different dimensions, the MPI can facilitate the targeting of priority areas and population subgroups, not just at the national, regional, or provincial level, but at the city, municipal, and village, or what we call barangay levels. And one possible source of information is the community-based monitoring system, and we've been monitoring the different dimensions of poverty in 1994. And the difference with the community-based monitoring system, the CBMS from other monitoring systems, is that it recognizes the important role of local governments in delivering services to the people. And so I don't think I have time, but basically this would show, the next two slides would show the different dimensions of poverty that can be monitored through the CBMS. And the corresponding indicators. So we could actually identify who are health poor, nutrition poor, housing poor, tenure poor, water poor, toilet poor, education poor, income poor, food poor, job poor, and security poor. And more importantly, these indicators actually have as a basis some policy issuances that designates them as official core local poverty indicators of the at the local level. So if I just have a minute, because it's not yet standing, what I can show you is that data for one community, one municipality in the Philippines in the south, which would actually shows the data from the CBMS, which is actually a census of households. So this particular example would cover about 4,822 households. We do have in our repository more than a million households for which MPI can be applied to. And so we, this shows actually there's no one-to-one correspondence between income poverty and non-income-based measures of poverty. So we have the magnitude and proportion for each of the different dimensions. And the data would actually show which households, the dots actually represent households. And so the green dots would represent households who are not income poor, and the red dots would indicate households who are income poor. Similarly for... Okay, you're not seeing it on the board, but I'm... Okay, seeing it in my computer. Anyway, I'll use. Okay, but basically, what is shown in the map would be dots that represent households. Okay, just to show an example of the data that we have, each dot represents actually a household. So a green dot represents a household that's not income poor, and a red dot would indicate a household that's income poor. And these are actually data collected using tablets, so you have GPS coordinates for each of the households. So similarly, for identifying households who are water poor, these are actually the red dots in the map. And we can actually count who the number of deprivations of each and every household. And what we're finding is that of the 10 deprivations that we looked at, the maximum number of deprivations would be 5, and only 2 households would actually have that. And what I've shown in the map is actually, if you look at the red dot, those are actually the households that have 5 deprivations, and their exact deprivations are listed in the map. So just to conclude, the MPI can be a complementary tool in monitoring multidimensional poverty together with the indicators for each of the different dimensions. MPI can be a useful tool in targeting geographical area and population subgroups. The indicators for the different dimensions can then be used to determine the package of interventions needed to reduce multidimensional poverty. And finally, MPI with CBMS multidimensional data can facilitate targeting at the local level, at the city, municipal, and village levels, and even at the household and individual levels. Thank you.